sold a house, bought a ticket to the West Coast. Now he gives them a stand-up routine in L.A.
Hello there, Lollygaggers. Got another week on tap here. This is, of course, Lollygagging Sports. I am your host, Bo Reed, along with my co-hosts, Samantha Bunten and Matthew Irby. And if Samantha, if I know you as well as I think you do, you're still dancing to some Billy Joel there.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Guys, I don't necessarily know every week what music he's going to choose. I love when we get something new. I'm a fan of Billy Joel. I like it. Excellent. Into it.
All right, well, it is Thanksgiving week. And one thing, Samantha, I think that we would be thankful for had we gotten it, would be some, significant baseball news. And obviously there's been some baseball news, but I dare to say it's not significant baseball news. I mean, like, the highlight so far this week was a pitching coach hire and a front office hire. That's about it.
Yeah, it's been pretty slow. The Angels are trading away pitching, so that's pretty predictable. And not acquiring pitching. And, Albert Pujols, probably turned 135 and won comeback player of the year. So that was cool. That was the good news. Otherwise, entirely too quiet.
Okay, am I wrong here? Irby, I'm going to bring you in on this as well, because I very well could be wrong, and I want to hear both of you, I want to hear your opinions on this, but isn't it a little weird for Verlander to just sweep, right? He gets Cy Young, he gets Comeback Player of the Year. I feel like that should have been a one or the other proposition.
Yeah, I mean, the other Cy Young candidates for the American League were not great, so I kind of get that, but I feel like if you're going to get the Cy Young, then maybe let someone else have a turn. I don't know. I don't like doubling up awards. The worst is when the Cy Young and the MVP, let's not have that. Let's not, unless Otani did it. That would be cool. I would get on board with that. But otherwise, yeah, don't be greedy. And one award to a person, there's not that many of them.
It's just okay, if you're good enough to win Cy Young, I mean, maybe do you really qualify for Comeback Player of the Year?
That's a very valid point. Did the year that Adrian Peterson won it in the NFL, did he also win MVP that year? Because I feel like that would have been weird if that happened. I feel like he didn't. I remember him being this very deserving Comeback Player of the Year award recipient, but then there was talk of MVP, and it was okay, calm down. Calm down. Enough. Well, it's one or the other, man.
I mean, let's also be honest here. About this, he came back from Tommy John. Okay, he came back from Tommy. What is so special about that? Baseball players have Tommy John all the time.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like he was good before and he was good after, and he was off in between having Tommy John, which is fine. Okay, good for him. He won a Cy Young. He deserved it. But be Comeback Player of the Year, don't you really have to be really, really down? Mm-hmm. Not just one more guy who got the same surgery as everyone else. I mean, it's not like he had a Lisfranc or something, where it takes 2 years and nobody knows if you're really ever going to be right again or whatever. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Also, just stop being greedy.
Yes.
Don't want to work. Settle down.
I don't think there's any question he's worthy. He deserves a Cy Young Award. He was the best pitcher in the American League. So don't I'm sure there's some Astros fans out there that still listen to our program that are probably mad at me right now because I'm picking on another Astro. But that's not what this is though. He's very deserving of that Cy Young. It's the Comeback Player of the Year that kind of irks. Irby, how about you? What do you think about this?
I'm in agreement of the issue with the comeback, just because this is not comeback from a down 2021. It's a non-existent 2021. It's a non-existent 2020. So what is he coming back? I mean, I'm with you guys. Is he coming? It's comeback from an injury, because I've always thought it was a comeback, redefining your career, refiguring out your career. And the last time he had a full season, 2019, he won the Cy Young. So Cy Young, injured Cy Young. No, I don't see Comeback Player in there. I'm with y'all. I'm not a fan of that. just because it is a now. I can get on board like last season where we had, was it Trey Mancini got it, and that's coming back from something totally different than Tommy John surgery. So,
well, and no, he's not doubling up. That's the whole problem.
Yes, yes. Also, well, but the thing is if he had, let's say Verlander last year pitches and he's below five, he's Patrick Corbin. Let's go there. We awarded Patrick Corbin last week a trophy. Patrick Corbin next year, if he, I'm sorry, I'm going to try and say this. If he suddenly figures it out and can win 20 games and strike out 300, he could win comeback player and Cy Young because he led the league in losses. And then a year later, not years later, not multiple years, 1 year later, if he can go from that to being the best pitcher next year, sure, I'm okay with you getting both awards. But it's not, no, this is not. You missed the season. It wasn't an injury. It's not. At this point, I mean, you would think Brett Favre would have had five or six comeback player of the years in the NFL.
Okay. I'm just thinking about all the times he was retiring and then coming back, and how that would technically be a comeback player of the year. I'm gonna stop. All right. Well, all award jokes aside, let's talk a little bit. I know we don't have a lot of news here with this baseball offseason, but I am curious which teams, and let's go with one. Which team? Give me a single team. Samantha, we'll start with you. Give me a single team that you're most intrigued by going into this offseason.
I'm not picking a single team. You can't make me.
Where's my mute button?
I mean,
there it is.
I mean, the Dodgers are always interesting, and I think they're particularly interesting this year because of some changing of the guard there. But the two teams, there's two teams that I'm primarily interested in for this, and it's Baltimore and Texas. Because those are two teams that I think are on the cusp of something, that will have money to spend, that are headed in the right direction, and might end up in a very, very different position than they were in this year. I think they're both kind of, like, ready. So they're the ones I'm most interested in, because they're going to be able to get out there and do some stuff this offseason that is going to, let's say, help their cause along and get them there a little bit quicker. But they're already headed in the right direction. So I prefer teams who are in transition for this, as opposed to a team like the Dodgers, where, yes, so it's interesting that they were good before. They're going to be good again. But I want to see these teams that I think are kind of on the cusp of something. What are they going to do to officially put themselves into the conversation for contention?
You know, Irby, what I find interesting about the Orioles in particular, this is not an ownership group that spends a lot of money. I mean, I know that they signed Chris Davis to that really, really awful contract. So they have in the past, but I get a sense, you know, just listening to some of the things that they have said, and, well, they was of course saying that throughout the regular season when the Orioles were contending much deeper in the season than we were expecting them to. So a lot of it could have been emotional and this and that, but there was a lot of talk about how they were going to dip into the deep end of this offseason. And now it's time to, of course, put your money where your mouth is and actually do it. But I'm intrigued by the Orioles as well. Irby, how about you?
Yes, love that addition there of Baltimore. I know that at the end of the day, one could sit here and go, well, you know, it's they finished fourth place, 16 games out. Yeah, well, the Yankees were, I mean, that was falling off. We saw how Baltimore was rising up. I mean, there was a time where we're sitting here thinking, are the Orioles going to finish second in this division? You know, because Tampa and Toronto just weren't getting the job done. So, yes, I love the addition of Baltimore here with the youth that they have, with the fact that we may be on the cusp of seeing them develop a starting pitcher. You know, no. Things like that. It's possible. They're sitting there. They're sitting there. This could be the year that we get a starting pitcher coming out of. So, yeah, long are the days of the Chris Davis contract, the having to let Manny Machado walk because you signed Chris Davis. Those are over. Those Baltimore days are over. And there is a possibility. And it's not like it's a long, long history. I mean, it's been a bad since 2017. It's been pretty bad. But the bright side, and you don't get to say this really at all in baseball, but the Baltimore Orioles, and I know y'all are going to make fun of me here, and that's okay. The Baltimore Orioles last year won more games than the last two seasons combined.
I'm just, Samantha, can you figure out where we're going to make fun of him there? I mean, all he did was state a fact.
Well, one of those was a COVID year where we only played 60 games. But whatever.
Oh, right.
Whatever. That makes it a little easier to get the job done. But still, that's fun little nugget of 77 wins between 2020 and 2021. They won 83 last year.
Well, see, there you go. See, I have successfully blocked 2020 out of my head. This is fantastic. I completely forgot about 20. Never mind. Samantha, anything you want to add here?
No, I'm good.
Okay, Irby, how about you? Who is your one team, which I guess can be three now that Samantha's done it, who are you intrigued by this offseason?
Well, I obviously one of them, I'll piggyback also what Samantha said with the Rangers, and that's just from a pure selfish standpoint. Yes, I'm very curious, and it's not my money. It's some billionaire's money, so spin, boys. But the one team that I'll touch in here that it's very interesting to see where they go from here, it would be the San Francisco Giants. This is an organization where, yes, the wonderful success of 2010, 2012, 2014, and then it, you know, there was a little bit as you get to 2016, and then it all kind of fell off after that. And from 2017 until 2021, they were non-existent. But then last year, you know, we're sitting here talking about these guys. Yeah, they might compete for third, and they win 107 games. They get knocked out of the divisional series, but still, it was a Giants team that were like, wow, look at them put it all together. And then you let Kevin Gausman walk. Yes, there's some great young pitching in this organization, but last year was a average year by pure definition. They finished 81-81, third in that division. And now you sit here with potentially your number one pitcher walking again in Rodon. And I know Logan Webb and there's some youth, but still, this is a Giants thing. And then we hear the news this week where they're out here entertaining Aaron Judge this week. I'm very curious to see the Giants, where they go, because this feels like 2022 could be a hiccup and they can get right back into this conversation. Or we might look back at if they don't figure something out, they don't make a signing, if Rodon walks and they don't get any big fish and they take another step back, we're going to look back at 2021 and be like, how did they do that? Like, what an outlier.
You know, Samantha, first of all, anything you want to add to what Irby was saying there?
No, but I mean, it is an interesting team, which I kind of wasn't paying much attention to them until they kept coming up in the Judge rumors. And I thought, that's really interesting. I was not expecting them to be part of this. And who knows how serious they really are in the Judge sweepstakes. I mean, we don't know where he's going. He may just go right back to New York. Although if I were him, I would run screaming from them.
Oh, absolutely.
But, you know, it would be a big commitment for a team like the Giants in a situation where I don't know if it makes sense, but it is kind of intriguing. And like Irby said, you know, are we going to end up looking back at that year and going, wow, that was just a weird fluky thing? Maybe. I don't know. I feel like we don't know that yet. We'll have to see what they do.
You know, I'm just going to throw it out there, but I think the odds of Judge in San Francisco is higher than Rodon going back to San Francisco.
Yeah, I agree with that.
You know, it just seems like, I mean, it's such a quick pivot. I understand, like, you know, it's Aaron Judge. But if I'm Rodon, if I'm sitting there in Rodon's camp, and I'm like, you know, you kind of pivoted to him, I'm still sitting here unsigned. You know, I feel like I'd be a little irked about that, but, you know, that is.
Oh, yeah, I think I agree with you. I think the message there is clear.
Yeah.
We're moving on. Yep.
Rodon's going to be fine. He's got plenty of suitors, including including the billionaires that Irby just mentioned there in Arlington. So I'm going to stay in the AL West here. I really only have one team to add to this conversation because I'm intrigued by all of those teams that you guys have been talking about. But there's really only one that I want to add to this conversation, and that's Seattle. because the Mariners figured some things out last year. I don't think there's any question about that. They figured some things out, but they're obviously not there. Now, they've got, I think they've got some starting pitching to compete with Houston, especially if Houston ends up losing Verlander. But there's still a lot of pieces that need to be filled. They need to get better in their bullpen. The back end of their bullpen needs to get better. They need to be able to hold on to leads in game one of the division series instead of blowing it late in the game. They need a little bit more offense. I mean, J-Rod's fantastic, but you got to get more pop in the middle of that order. So looking at where they're at, looking at how they closed the season, which in their case was the postseason, you look at, you guys mentioned Texas. Texas is going to spend some money this offseason. They're looking at pitching, maybe even adding a big bat in the middle of that order. Texas is going to come on strong. I think it's a very important offseason for the Mariners, because if they don't keep up with the Astros, if they don't keep up with what the Rangers are about to do, more than likely, at least all indications are, spending-wise, then this last year, very well, instead of being that promising next step, could be a one-and-done.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. It's a really intriguing situation for them. I mean, in some ways, I think they're kind of not in a great spot, because, like, Houston's not going anywhere. Even if we think, okay, they'll take somewhat of a step back because, well, almost everybody does after they win the World Series, right? Like, right. They usually don't win two in a row, and they don't look like one of those teams that's just going to be a juggernaut. Provisional World Series, sorry. Forgot to put the provisional World Series. But Texas is coming. You know, I mean, we can all ignore the, you know, Los Angeles Angels of California, Tijuana, Anaheim, whatever. That's, I mean, we all know what they're going to do, and they're going Baja. To keep Maybe doing Baja. What they always do. Baja Angels. But, like, you have a problem if you're Seattle, because if your big splash was to basically come on in the second half, embarrass yourselves in the playoffs, only to get what, like, passed by Texas because they have better pipeline talent than you do, like, and they're willing to spend the money. Like, you can't, like, okay, the starting pitching is probably fine, could use a little help. They need a lot of help in the back end of the bullpen, like you said. And also, like, I mean, Julio Rodriguez is amazing, but he's one guy. Mm-hmm. Like, there are a lot of people who are offensive starters on that team who are, it's not like you need to replace everybody, but, like, there are plenty of spots where you could upgrade, and you're going to have to, because otherwise, like, you're right back where you started with Houston. Now Texas is a problem. Like, I don't think, I mean, look at who was in the wild card race this year. Baltimore is coming. You know, Boston's probably going to be back. New York's not going anywhere. Cleveland's not going anywhere. The White Sox might be better. Like, those wild card spots are not going to come easy either. And wouldn't that be kind of embarrassing to end up in third place in your division? Like, they need a lot of work just to keep up. It's a rough spot to be in.
Yeah, you know, and Irby, if I were a Mariners fan, I think that what would probably scare me the most is all of the publicity, everything about the Mariners was breaking that postseason drought, right? Like, they hadn't been in the postseason since 2001, and that wasn't a great postseason for them back then either. Getting so caught up with that and putting so much energy into making the playoffs, finally breaking that drought, just to have this kind of go about, like, oh, well, we finally broke the drought. That's good enough for us. Because, unfortunately for Seattle and their fans, that has kind of been the MO there for the last 20, 25 years.
Yeah, Bo, you're talking about scary things, and you mean outside of their own general manager? Yeah, absolutely. Scary enough as he is, which it's the funny thing about him, you know, he just can't help himself, and he has to make trades. And here we are already. They address in a trade exactly the two things you guys have talked about, but not necessarily in the positive way. We've got the trade for Teoscar Hernandez, which is great. Awesome. You've added some pop. You know, there's already some decent pop, but you've added another bat, an outfield bat. And so Seattle's offense is going to be improved. But then you get rid of Eric Swanson, and I can't with this. I can't. I mean, this was one of your lockdown bullpen guys. He won 1.68 ERA over 57 games. I mean, I know this isn't a big saves guy or anything, but still, this is a guy that you could trust in the seventh, eighth inning to come in when you needed to get your team out of a jam, and he was doing that. And now he's pitching for a team, like you mentioned, Samantha, who you will be directly competing with for those wild card spots.
Yeah, see, I've always had that sense about Seattle. The late 90s were just an anomaly, I think, when they were competitive year in and year out, and they were doing the things that you do to stay competitive year in and year out. I have not seen that from Seattle since that 2001 season.
Yeah, and they just seem, I mean, I think you could take it back even further than that because they didn't get anywhere. They embarrassed themselves in the postseason there. But, like, yeah, if you go back to the late 90s, like, yeah, they seem to function just like every other sort of well-constructed team that had money and that most of the talent was homegrown. They filled it in by paying people. Like, they just seem kind of lost now. And, I mean, we can all laugh at Jerry and Irby, like, you're right. Like, I mean, who knows? You know, I mean, trading Swanson away to your direct competition for a wild card spot seems incredibly foolish, but like they just do stuff, you know. I mean, this has always been the knock on them, right? They're just doing stuff. Like, I'm bored today. Let's make a trade, and you're like, how is this making your team better? Like, I just feel like they're gonna flounder around, and all of a sudden they're gonna find themselves looking up at both Houston and Texas in their division, and find themselves way out of the wild card, and it's like, well, what a waste. I mean, you want to be the next Anaheim? You really condemn Julio Rodriguez so that the same faith as poor Otani and Trout have? They're a little less dumb, but not much.
Irby, anything else you want to add here before we skip on over to the NFL?
No, just that, I mean, I appreciate Seattle keeping even. You know, Seattle and the Angels both, you know, it's a time of Thanksgiving. I'm thankful that they just continue to be themselves in the way trading, away pitching, or in Seattle's case, you know, trades just for the sake of making a trade.
All right. So, Samantha, this week, of course, we're going to take a look at these Thanksgiving Day matchups. A reminder, we are recording this the night before Thanksgiving, so it seems like a good idea to talk about the games that are happening on Thanksgiving Day. Let's start. We're going to go in order. So let's start with the Bills at the Lions. Samantha, we've talked about the Bills a lot on this program, but I think maybe we should start to, I don't say start because I think we talked about this earlier in the season, but things have not gotten better. Let's put it that way. Things have not gotten better on the injury front for the Buffalo Bills. How much of a problem is this becoming?
Yeah, I mean, this is rough. Part of the problem is I don't think they expected, or any of us really expected, that division to be as tight as it is. So they're certainly, I think, contending with a lot more push from underneath from the other teams in the East than anybody thought that they would be. But they've also had, I'm not going to call it catastrophic injury problems, because catastrophic would probably mean Josh Allen was just out. But, you know, Allen is not 100%, and it shows. We have seen that. I mean, I've heard some ridiculous assessments. Oh, he's regressing on his accuracy. It's like, well, you know, he has a really, really, like, effed up UCL. Like, this is not a regression. It's an injury. But they also have a ton of injuries on the defense. So they've been able to kind of weather this so far. But it is affecting them, because the talent level on this team, like, even if we're like, okay, the Jets are better than we thought, the Dolphins, the Patriots, whatever, the Bills at full strength are still the best team in that division. Mm-hmm, they should still be significantly ahead of the competition, and the fact that they're not tells me that this is a concern, and it's going to continue to be a concern because we still have this injury issue, and it's been going on for weeks. They lost two of their last three. You know, I mean, they're okay. Those are tough matchups. I fully expect they'll win the division, but you know, it's looking like a much more of a slog than we were anticipating, and it's because they have a lot of critical people in and out of the lineup pretty regularly.
I always get a kick out of these quarterbacks when they get a baseball injury, and like NFL fans just don't seem to understand what that quarterback's dealing with. Regression? No, he's got a bum elbow. Let's call it what it is. Irby, how about you? Any thoughts on this one?
It's two teams that are having, like, don't panic. That really is the big thing here. You are 10 games in a 17-game schedule, in a season, and then I'm talking about Buffalo here, obviously, in a season where regular season means jack squat. This is all about January. This is about getting to that game in February and winning that game. So take your time, figure things out, work different. You know, I mean, this is a marathon. I mean, we can bring the baseball reference in here for Buffalo. This is a marathon. Get healthy, get ready for the next step, because it doesn't matter if you win the division or not. Yes, you would love to play the home game. Sure, absolutely. You've got bigger fish to fry, and that is understand your whole roster, get everybody involved. I'm not concerned about Buffalo. It's a hiccup. It's a hiccup. Yeah. All teams that win Super Bowls have hiccups. Mm-hmm. Okay. Detroit, on the other end, man, this is fun. This is great. Three-game winning streak. You know, it's well-deserving. And the best part for Detroit is as they continue to win games, their first-round draft pick continues to get better because the Rams can win games. So the Lions, this is perfect. Like, your youth is getting better, and you're going to have a top draft pick. Awesome.
Well, Samantha, let's talk about those Lions because, you know, as Irby mentioned, three-game winning streak. Let's break them up. They're at four wins now. They're 4-6. They just dismantled the Giants in New York, which, you know what? I'm not going to take anything away from the Lions. I'm just not going to. I think the Giants have been soft. I think they are one of the softest winning teams in the NFL, but I'm not taking that away from the Lions. How are we feeling now? Now that we're halfway through the season, over halfway through the season, they're starting to put together a nice little run. 5 wins, 6 wins, 7 wins. I mean, all of that is possible, and that would exceed the preseason expectations of this team. They may have actually exceeded already.
Yeah, I mean, it's a weird year. Because as much as I want to be excited about this and I want the Lions to do well, and, you know, we all love Dan Campbell and it's hilarious to see them in, like, second place in their division, and the fact that they're not out of the wild card conversation just doesn't say anything good about the NFC. But I'm not sure I think this is a good thing for Detroit to go on a run like this, because two things. Number one, you need draft picks. Your roster does not have anywhere near the level of talent that it needs. You're playing over your own head right now. They're a well-coached team. They're very motivated. There are some guys, but they have a lot of holes in that roster. So the higher you're drafting, the better. The other problem is you don't want to get stuck in, like, the Jared Goff feedback loop where it's like, oh, he looked like he was good enough. Guess we don't need to draft a quarterback. We'll just re-sign Jared Goff. And it's like, guys, man, we know how this goes. Like, so I'm not sure it's a good thing for the Lions to do. I mean, we want them to do well enough, but I think we all know that, you know, the organization believes in Dan Campbell and that coaching staff. Like, they're going to be around. And I don't know that, like, picking in the middle of the round is going to help you. I mean, yeah, you got the Rams pick. That's helpful. The Rams suck. That was an unexpected bonus, but you have a lot of holes to fill on that roster. You got a lot of work to do. So I don't know if I think it's a good thing for the Lions to go on some sort of run here.
Irby, anything you want to add to that before we get into, before we actually pick this game?
Oh, no, just that I 100% agree. Like, as much fun as it is to watch this, this is a team that needs to be focused on the future. This is the one where I say it all the time about my teams when they're in that rebuild mode. When it's like, how do you want them to play? I want the youth to play. I want them to develop. I want them to be competitive. And then when the game's on the line, just fall a little bit short. So that you feel good about, we were in this game, man, we can compete, but you're taking the losses and you're getting that improved draft pick. Because I 100% agree. This Lions team, what you've kind of got here, what you're starting to build, two top 10 draft picks would be another huge boost. And I say that with looking, you know, not fixed, but what the Jets did and what they were able to get with Sauce Gardner and Garrett Wilson. Not saying you would do the same thing, but look at what two things can automatically do. That would be great for Detroit next year.
All right, let's pick this one. Who do you have here, Samantha, Bills or Lions?
Oh, the Bills. I think this is going to be a more interesting game then theoretically it should have been coming into this season. But and I hope it is. I hope the Lions acquit themselves well, especially because it's Thanksgiving and we want the Lions to do well there. But ultimately, the Bills are still the better team, whether they are beat up or not.
Irby, how about you?
Yeah, same thing. Second place Bills beat the second place Lions.
You just wanted to say second-place Lions. I see what you're doing there.
I did. Samantha did it too earlier. It's great. It's awesome. Right, Green Bay? Right, Green Bay? Packer fans, hello? Anybody there? No? No?
Yeah, you know, I think they stopped listening. The second that someone says second-place Lions is when they tuned us out. That's okay, though. That's okay. We have other fans. Giants are at the Cowboys. This game... I guess the best way to sum it up is it looks better than it did before the season started. Let's start, Samantha, with the Giants ground game against the Cowboys defense. This is, of course, a Cowboys defense that 2 weeks ago gave up 200 yards to the Packers, and then last week gave up basically nothing to a red-hot Minnesota Vikings team. Now, I want to say this before we get really into the matchup here about these Cowboys. They're not as – what you saw last week was the ceiling. The Packers game, I think, was the floor. We're going to wind up somewhere in the middle between those two for most of these matchups going forward. But let's talk Giants ground game. Giants took another hit to their wide receiver core. They desperately need Odell Beckham now. Not sure that's going to happen. But do you think that's going to put more of an emphasis here? Like they're going to have to use that ground game more than they were maybe planning to before they lost another wide receiver?
Well, the thing that's weird about the Giants ground game is that, like, a lot of that yardage, actually most of that yardage, is Daniel Jones running. Mm-hmm. It's not Saquon Barkley. So, which is not because Saquon can, it's because I think they kind of correctly, like, realize that, like, this is not a particularly durable guy, so they're using him sparingly, but they're using him kind of too sparingly, so it's a little bit of a different challenge going up against Dallas, because it's really the quarterback who's picking up most of those yards on the ground. So the question is, you know, can Dallas basically stop a rushing quarterback, which is something that I think theoretically, yes, but for the Giants, I don't know that you can necessarily lean on the ground game, because Saquon's not a grinder, and Daniel Jones is, your quarterback can't be your whole ground game. This is the same problem Buffalo ran. They're going to get him killed. So that's not necessarily the correct answer to this, I think. But they do need help in the passing game. I mean, if there was ever a team where you could make a great argument, like, sign Odell. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know he left there on bad terms, but guys, he leaves everywhere on bad terms, right? Like, the guy has a fit and gets himself traded, and then he has another fit and gets himself traded again. And, like, man, now he's like the mercenary version of LeGarrette Blount. You know, whoever signs him is going to the Super Bowl, and then he'll go somewhere else. You know, he plays half a season. Whatever, cool. Look, Odell, yeah, it worked for the Rams. It worked. I don't know that that's necessarily going to be true going forward. So I would be careful if I were the Giants, how much I invested in that. But probably you're not really going to have to invest that much. So, like, why not try it? So it's a little bit of money, which will be contained within the framework of the salary cap this season only. So you're not exactly damaging your future prospects. So, like, I mean, why not? Like, there's no one to throw to. I mean, sooner or later, you're going to have to develop a passing game. And I think what's going to happen here is I think that weakness is going to get exposed going up against that Dallas defense, which might sort of propel them into action on this front.
Well, I don't think there's any question they want to sign him. But the other team, the team they're playing, the Cowboys are also in on Odell Beckham, so it may not be as simple as, yeah, we're willing to sign you, yeah, but I'm already signing the contract here in Dallas. And
well, wouldn't you rather go to Dallas?
I would. Odell? Yeah.
I mean, yeah, like, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I would. Absolutely, I would. You know, like, you got a better shot at winning with the Cowboys than you do the Giants. I mean, unless you want to go to the Eagles or some of these other teams that have maybe a better shot at winning the Super Bowl. But absolutely, I think I'd rather go to Dallas than the Giants right now. Irby, how about you? Any thoughts on any of this? We could talk, you know, Cowboys defense, Giants round game, or Odell Beckham, or all three. You know, what you got?
Good stuff. First of all, Samantha, thank you for throwing out the LeGarrette Blount. I appreciate that. You know, earlier this week we talked to Ndamukong Suh, it's kind of the Fernando Rodney. LeGarrette Blount, another great one of just, yeah, he just appears and wins the Super Bowl. So great. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. The angle I want to take on this, and this is unfortunate for the Giants, but I think it's over. Like, I see the record. And I know what you've got, and that Daniel Jones is taking steps forward, and Saquon, but what the Lions just did to you, Dallas is going to do and make it worse, and that's a problem. And the reason behind this is the injury concerns, because you don't have an offensive line anymore. They're all hurt. I said, oh, sorry, right guard. Apparently, the entire depth chart at right guard is healthy. So the Giants, running through the, you know, that was that 2-3 gap, are going to be perfectly fine. Outside of that, this is going to be ugly. When I'm looking at the run pressure and the pass. I mean, just the pressure period, run pass, whatever you want to say, with what the Cowboys can do, what they just did to Minnesota, and what the Giants are struggling with. I think this game's going to be ugly, and it's going to be Dallas's defense literally feasting on Turducken and Daniel Jones.
Well, I guess, Samantha, to Irby's point there about the Giants, this is a team that we've also talked about and where they are with these newfangled stats we call the luck metrics. At least I think we do. That's what I call them. What are you making of where they're at now? Samantha, this is a Giants defense, for example, that isn't all that good, and that's kind of funneling where they're at within these luck metrics, is it not?
Oh, it absolutely is, because part of the reason why they rank so high, in terms of, you know, the luckiest teams, because they're top five luck, and then the reason for that is because of the number of takeaways that they've had, which is largely dependent on luck. I mean, we can talk about creating turnovers, sure, but recovering fumbles, the element of luck is huge in that. And if you're bad in every other valid defensive metric, but you're good at takeaways, that tells you something. That's not going to hold up, right? You're not going to keep getting that lucky. So absolutely, that's what that is. So, and then, you know, Irby mentioned the injuries to the offensive line, which is going to make it a lot harder for Daniel Jones to kind of do what he does. They don't have a lot of other weapons on the offense. So they've been incredibly lucky. They're playing over their heads. They're very well coached. So, I mean, good for Brian Daboll. I mean, this team is going to get better if they draft well and if they're smart in the offseason. But, yeah, I mean, I think that teams that are both lucky and good in terms of roster talent, like teams like the Eagles, teams like the Cowboys, then the luck is just one more thing you can throw in there. But you're not dependent on it, right? Like, Dallas is not having a good season because they've been lucky. They're having a better season because they've been lucky. Same thing with Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Teams like Minnesota and the Giants, especially the Giants, probably more than anyone, like, if you're only having a good season because you've been lucky, this is not to say they were going to be a terrible team, and certainly they're better than we expected because they are so well coached. But if luck is the biggest determining factor in your season being far better than it should have been, that is not something that's going to be sustainable. So those 11-win Giants that we talked about a couple of weeks ago, I don't know if we're going to get there. And I think this is going to be a very ugly week for them.
Well, I mean, obviously we're going to pick this. I think the two of you have already kind of telegraphed how you're going to pick here. But, you know, this is my job on the program. I have to ask this question. So, Samantha, who do you have, Giants or Cowboys?
Oh, Dallas. Yeah, I think this is, as Irby mentioned, sort of where we start to see the true unraveling of the Giants. You know, last week we could have said that's a fluke. Detroit's a little plucky, but I think this game is going to go in a very, very similar way. And this is sort of the beginning of the end, unfortunately. Sorry, Giants fans. I wouldn't wish this on you guys, but I don't think this is your year.
Irby, how about you? Giants or Cowboys?
Bo, you set that up well as like one of my times that I just sit here and suddenly like give you this weird random stat that makes total sense of why the Giants are going to win, and it would be perfect for Thanksgiving, and I don't have that stat this week. It's going to be ugly.
Okay, but you know, just so everyone knows, he was traveling, you know, making the drive into deep West Texas. So, you know, he didn't really have an opportunity to find a stat.
Well, yeah, that's true. But the stat also doesn't exist. It's not going to be pretty.
Oh, wow. Okay, well, never mind. You know what? I'd say what's really maddening here, guys, is the obvious pick is Dallas. Right? That is the obvious pick here. I'd be surprised if anyone is picking the Giants, except the fact that Dallas, this is the kind of game that the Cowboys lose. A game that they need. A game that they need to stay relevant in the NFC East race, to stay relevant in the NFC playoff picture. They need this. You can't lose a game like this looking at everything else they have on their schedule. You can't lose this one. And this is exactly the kind of game that Dallas loses. So I am also picking the Cowboys. I am. But I will be eating my turkey, watching the Cowboys, and I'm not going to be comfortable. I wasn't comfortable with the Vikings game on Sunday until CBS cut away. Then I was comfortable.
Yeah, I think that's a valid point. The only thing that makes me feel better about this than I normally would is they just had their conquer 2 weeks ago against Green Bay. So we might be a little early on the, like, just Dallas not showing up type of game. So I think you're going to be okay. But I only say that because we just saw the, like, disaster game for Dallas.
I hope you're right. I hope you're right. All right. The night game. Thanksgiving Day is Patriots at those same Vikings. So we're gonna start here with the Patriots, Samantha. Say what you will about Josh McDaniels as a head coach, and there's plenty we can say. There's a lot. But he was a pretty good coordinator for the Patriots, and right now they really could. How much are they missing him right now in New England?
Oh, so much. So much. Like, yes, Josh McDaniels is a disaster as a head coach, but he is a really, really good offensive coordinator. And what they're doing right now is just, I mean, look at Mac Jones. Look how much he's regressed. And I think it's lazy to say, oh, he just outperformed metrics a year ago and he's really not very good. No, he's being completely misused. I mean, they're running this, like, vertical offense, which is pretty much exactly the opposite of what Mac Jones does well and what they need to do to be successful as an offense. It's like the play calling doesn't match the personnel. And what do we always say? Like, you match your scheme and your play calling to the players you have, not the other way around. Because you can't afford to run a football team like that. And Mac Jones was fine. And now he just looks like a shell of himself. And, like, he's clearly lost his confidence. And he's being asked to play a very different role than the one he was playing a year ago. Because a year ago, this was the standard Patriots offense where essentially there's a lot of checkdowns, a lot of crossing routes, and you're looking for a quarterback who is, let's say, smart and accurate as opposed to particularly talented and athletic. And now we're trying to run a vertical game? That makes absolutely no sense. Not just with Mac Jones, but with any of the personnel that you have on that offense. So, yes, say what you will about Josh McDaniels, who is just a terrible disaster of a head coach, but he's a really, really good coordinator, and he's certainly good for the Patriots. And I fully believe, by the way, that he will be the Patriots offensive coordinator again next year. Because that's, you know, it's going to be just like, he's just going to go right back there after the Raiders fire him, and then everything will be fine. But, you know, it's a little rough in the interim here.
Irby, anything you want to add to that?
I don't know why you're saying next year. I don't understand how this can happen later this season. If New England keeps, you know, finding ways to win games and get that playoff spot, that McDaniels might have to get let go. Right, like, can I get out of here so I can go join their playoff team? Like, this may get done this season.
I'll take it a step further. I'm surprised it hasn't happened already. All right, so Samantha, the one thing that we talk about this at least once a year. We get a matchup, you know, with the Patriots and somebody, and we go on about how Belichick just likes to take out that one guy, right? Like he will pinpoint the player he wants to take out of the game. Now, this is particularly dangerous for the Minnesota Vikings because Belichick has probably the best piece of film he's seen in quite some time because Dallas on Sunday shut everybody down. So now he can pick which one he wants to shut down and take a look at how Dallas did it. He's got everything he needs on one piece of film. That does not bode well for the Vikings.
Yeah, it probably doesn't because, look, Belichick doesn't have the defensive talent to work with that Dallas does. But like you said, what he does is he's just going to take away your best thing and then he's going to make you beat him another way. And that's been good enough for the Patriots for a very, very long time, and it's going to continue to be so. They're not going to beat up on Minnesota the way Dallas did, but they don't need to. It's going to take your best piece off the board. And like you said, he's got the best piece of film, all of it wrapped up and tied with a bow in one game. Thank you, Dallas, for essentially handing that to him, because what he can do is go back through that and say, okay, well, the smart play is probably to take Justin Jefferson off the board, right? Maybe. Maybe. Or would you rather take out the ground game? And that's really more about what Belichick wants to do in terms of timing. Are you more concerned about keeping the ball out of the offensive's hands? Or are you more concerned with just shutting down their best offensive weapon? And we don't really know what he's going to do yet, but he has a lot of options, and he's only got to watch one tape to do it. So, again, thank you, Cowboys.
you just see Belichick like, No. I just need one piece of just that Dallas. It's all I need. Everything's on there. Everything's
talking
on that
to tent. His husky.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like looking over at the husky. You know, the husky that sits in the chair next to him during the draft, and be like, "Listen, buddy, we only have to watch one of these tonight. Good news."
Oh boy, Irby, how about you? Anything you want to add here before we pick them?
The last thing is I'm very, very intrigued by this matchup, just because it's New England for all the faults, the headaches, the issues they have, you're one game out of first place. You're right there in the conversation. And you've beaten, you know, the team below you, the Jets, you've beaten them twice. Like you're in actually not terrible position. And Minnesota is going to be desperate to get on the field again and prove that last week at Dallas was just it was just one of those weeks. It was basically a bye week. So this matchup of all the matchups, I'm very excited about this because of it just prove this is an opportunity for both teams to prove they are good and they are going to be a playoff team and they can make noise and not to anyone else, just to themselves. This is a big, big game for both the teams to prove to themselves.
All right, let's pick this one. Samantha, who you got here?
Yeah, Irby's right. This is a really important game for both teams. Minnesota, again, with the luck. They've been lucky. I don't know. They also have a lot of talent, though. But, I mean, one thing I would throw out there is we haven't seen a true Kirk Cousins game in a while, you know, where he does something just, like, unbelievably buffoonish. So, you know, keep your eyes out for that. Look, I might get burned on this one, but I actually think New England takes this. I think Minnesota's just going to get out smarter than this one.
Okay, Irby, how about you?
Yeah, I love the outsmarting. Well, see, but Kirk Cousins is buffoonish. He's dancing around shirtless with ice on him, so he's doing his buffoonery on plane rides, and not on the field. Is that can I? No, no, that's not going to work. I'm going to default to the home team and take Minnesota. I'm not confident in that pick at all. I just feel like, you know, I felt even more confident before last week when they only scored 3 points. But I feel like they can score more. They're going to score more than three, and it doesn't take a ton of points to beat New England. So Minnesota, just because the offensive talent there is better, is going to find a way to squeak out a home win. But I'm not confident in this decision at all.
I'm also going to take the Patriots here. I'm agreeing with you, Samantha. And, you know, all joking aside about you know, Belichick, he's got this one little piece of film. All joking aside, Dallas may have exposed that Minnesota offense just a little bit on Sunday.
I think so.
Because like the way, because yeah. That was a lot of that. Yeah, Dallas has a talented defense. Of course they do. But a lot of that was Dan Quinn. And a lot of that was the way he was scheming, the way he was stunting on that defensive line, the way he was mixing up his looks. He was mixing up blitz versus non-blitz. The way he was doing that confused Kirk Cousins and enabled Dallas to just absolutely throttle the Vikings. Belichick, as you mentioned, Samantha, is a very smart, defensive-minded coach. I think he could find those schemes within his talent base at other teams for the rest of the season and will as well.
Yeah, 100%, 100%. I'm glad you mentioned the stunting because that was huge in that. And their Minnesota's offensive line just came apart. I mean, we could blame Kirk for some of it, but, like, most of those sacks were not on him. I mean, they just blew them up. And like you said, Belichick doesn't necessarily need the same level of talent to achieve similar results. He also doesn't need to run the score up that way. Like, only got to get one more point than the other team to get a win, and that's pretty much how the Patriots do it. So,
I think after blowing a 14-point lead to Aaron Rodgers, the Cowboys were just not safe at all with any lead, so they just kept going. That's what happened.
Oh yeah, well, they needed, they had to do that. I mean, Dallas, you had to. You got embarrassed by Green Bay a week ago. You got to come back and say, "Look, this was the Wade Phillips bye week fluke game. We're fine." They had to.
Okay, so that's going to wrap up the NFL part of this. So we are now at our time capsule segment. Just a reminder, this is obviously new, so over the next few weeks, we're going to keep recapping what this is, so those of you playing at home understand what we're doing here. We're taking an NFL team that hasn't done something in a while. Now, it's not always a Super Bowl. I know last week I let us off with the last time the Redskins won the Super Bowl. It doesn't have to be the Super Bowl. It doesn't even necessarily have to be the playoffs. We're picking an NFL team that hasn't done something in a while, and we're taking a look at the pop culture of that year. And it's going to cycle through. I went last week. Irby's going this week. He's got a scenario for Samantha and I to try to figure out. He's going to give us some hints. We're going to try to guess these pop culture items that he has brought for us tonight. You, of course, listening at home or in your car on your way to Thanksgiving dinner, more than welcome to play along. Tweet us if you want to play. As you're playing along, you can tweet at us. Our Twitter handles are in that show bio. The stipulation, of course, is we are only going back to, it's 1980. That's as far back as we're going to go because we didn't want to go too far back. So, Irby, what do you have tonight?
All right. Well, thank you, Bo. Yeah, it's fun to be on this side of it. Usually I'm on the one guessing because you're the hostess with the mostest, but you guys always do great at this. So I'm going to try and pull this off here, but I'm going to go with, you know, it's been fun. Well, fun for everybody outside of the state of Colorado to talk, you know, it's been kind of weird and fun to watch with the Denver Broncos. You know, when they go all in and sometimes it doesn't pay off, and I'm going to pick a Denver Broncos team that was seeded number one. I know they have a couple Super Bowl titles, but we're not talking about that. I want to talk about that 1989, going into the 1989 Broncos. But we're not worried about 1989. We're worried about when the calendar flipped, and it became 1990. And those Broncos found their way through the postseason, and they got to a Super Bowl, and things went really, really, really bad. And it feels like the Broncos are trying that again. Definitely not at the Super Bowl level. But things are going really, really bad for Denver as they've gone all in again.
Ooh,
1990.
See, Samantha, you see what he's doing, right? He's trying to get us to crisscross between the 80s and 90s by going with 1990 because there's some fudgery between 1989 and 1990 that makes it difficult to pick between the 80s and the 90s.
I think this whole era is tough. Like, everything that's between, like, 88 and, like, 92 or 93, like, there's a lot of similarity in things, yeah. like the style of music, the style of clothing, sort of what people, it's a little bit, it's tricky in there knowing whether it's even which decade it is when you get towards the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s. Very tricky.
Yeah.
Well, and I can help you guys out a little, just to kind of get your mindset, you know, get your mind right, you know, think back to when, you know, because we were all alive, we were all kids here. Granted, I was totally different mindset during all this because I was a 49ers fan, and that was a good game. That was a good Super Bowl. That was a lot of fun. But if you're a Broncos, it wasn't so much. So fun, I mean, just kind of put your mindset of the Broncos. So this was their fourth Super Bowl appearance in 13 years. Yes, they went the dreaded 0-4. The funny thing about it is all four of those losses, if you added up all the points that they scored from those four Super Bowls, it still wasn't enough points to have won that day in 1990 against the 49ers because they only scored 50 points in four Super Bowls. So that's why you lost four. But to kind of get continue, so let's look at some worldly things before I really get you guys having to guess some stuff here. In the year 1990, so Tim Berners-Lee created the first web server, and that was the foundation for the World Wide Web.
Oh.
And it was also the year that we launched the Hubble telescope. I know that's kind of old news now, but still, Hubble telescope was a big deal.
Hang on.
Throughout the 90s.
Question. Was that with the broken lens that then had to be repaired? Or was that the repaired lens?
No, this was the launch. This was the initial launch. So.
Get that thing up there and it's out of focus.
Yes. So, all right. So, being the guy that I am, I'm gonna ease y'all into this, and it might ease you, and it might frustrate you guys even more here. So I'm actually going to make you guys talk about the year 1990, and how well can you claim or can you identify other champions in the realm of sports? Ooh. 1990, what happened in the World Series?
In 1990, that was the... I know the Twins won it in 91, right? So didn't they go back-to-back, Samantha? Didn't they win 90 and 91?
No.
No?
I know the answer to this, but I'm not going to say it yet.
1990.
We want to give you guys a little bit of an opportunity here. But no, they did
not. It was
not
the Twins.
The winner in 1990 was an NL team.
Ooh. The other team, though, was a back-to-back.
Yeah. Although they lost, so.
That's true. Was it back-to-back, but it was a loss.
In there.
Featuring, there's a theme here. Manager, somebody who we spoke about a week ago in the awards segment.
Well, and there's a fun theme here, as you're going to start figuring out, because we had a Super Bowl, 55-10. We got a World Series that went the minimum. That helps you, Bill.
Yep. Took it in four.
1990. Okay, so let's see. The San Francisco earthquake was, what, 89? So that was Giants A's. 90 was obviously the A's because we talked about Tony La Russa last week.
Right.
So who did
they... Yeah, the A's lost, that's why.
Who did they lose to in 90? Because that's 2 years after Gibson. Who did they lose to in 1990? That's a thought that's going to fester.
Well, it's going to drive you crazy here in a second, Bill. Samantha, you want to go ahead? I think we've given everyone a whole chance. You want to guess for us here, Samantha? Tell us who it is.
Yeah, it's the Reds.
It is the Reds of Cincinnati.
Oh.
Yeah. All right, so... Continue. Maybe a little bit harder here for you guys, but can y'all identify the NBA Finals champ in 1990?
Yeah.
It was Detroit, wasn't it?
Ooh.
Yeah, Detroit. The Pistons.
Good job. Y'all remember who they beat? Or
Portland, I think.
Very good. Yes, in a kind of on the same theme here, only took five games. Detroit won 4-1. So keep moving. Stanley Cup?
I'm out.
Oh boy. Oh, that was before my cup days. Who was good in the early 90s? Wait, Which conference? Was it West? Probably West.
Well, see, that's what they, back in the 90s, I can't remember who was here. I will tell you this. It wasn't pretty. It took five games. And this team won their fifth Stanley Cup in 7 years. This was the end of that run. And they haven't done a darn thing since. Kind of works out great with what we're talking about with Denver, Cincinnati, and kind of Detroit here.
Canadian or American team?
It is a Canadian team.
Okay.
They had a pretty good hockey player on that team, and it's the reason why they won 5 out of 7.
Uh-huh.
Oh, even... Okay, I know who it is then. I mean, assuming we're talking about the player that I think you're talking about.
So the Maple Leafs?
No, it was not. You want to take a stab there, Samantha?
Is it the Oilers?
It is the Edmonton Oilers. And some kid named Wayne was on that team. He was pretty good.
No, he was traded.
Yeah, he was traded to the Kings by then.
Yeah.
Oh, so this would have been, was it when Mark Messier was still on that team?
That's who I thought you were talking about.
Okay.
Yeah, he would have been on the Kings by then, I think.
Ah, done. All right, so I'm going to give you two others. No, I'm going to give you three other fun little nuggets.
Yeah, you got the hockey. You got the hockey question. I didn't.
I'm going to give you guys three others because I like this world champions. Good. I mean, just real quick. Hey, we're in the middle of the World Cup. Do you guys know what happened in the World Cup that year?
1990?
No. I don't even remember what happened in the last World Cup.
The World Cup champion was West Germany, defeated Argentina 1-0. Interesting point because both of those teams continuing on our theme of choking here. Argentina and Germany not having a good last couple days.
No. I heard about Argentina. I did not hear about Germany.
Germany lost to Japan 2-1, giving up two late goals. So nice. Tough day for them.
Yeah.
Brazilian phenom Ayrton Senna won his second out of three F1 titles while driving for McLaren. Fun little nugget here too. Susan Butcher went on to win her fourth Iditarod dog sled race in 5 years. In 1986, she became the first woman to ever win the race and then went on to win 4 out of 5. Great job, Susan. But Bo, this one's, these are definitely for you because Bo, you're kind of our fan here of sports. You're a big golfer, Bo. You like your golf, right?
I do like my golf. Yes.
Yeah. In 1990, who was the USGA US amateur champ?
In 1990. That's got to be too early for Tiger Woods, right? Or is it?
It is too early for Tiger Woods.
It's early for Tiger.
I know who it is.
Samantha, you're cleaning my clock, okay? God, 1990. Not Phil Mickelson, is it?
Yep.
It is. Well done, you two.
Is it Lefty? Okay.
Lefty. Yep. Lefty. The U.S. amateur champ. Continuing with youth there, in the U.S. Men's Open, the men's U.S. Open tennis, crowned their youngest champion ever in 1990. Either of you have an idea who it is?
Well, I'm gonna. I have a guess. I don't know the answer to this, but I have a good guess.
You got anything before I throw her a guess out?
I got a couple of guesses here.
All right, so Samantha, throw your guess, and Bo, you throw me yours.
Pete Sampras.
Bo, what do you got?
That was not my guess, but I think she's right.
What was your guess?
My guess was going to be Agassi or Federer.
Ah, no, this is definitely for Federer. But Samantha, you are rolling tonight. Yes, 19-year-old Pete Sampras.
Man.
So, all right, one last sports nugget. Boxing in the year 1990 had arguably one of the greatest heavyweight upsets in modern boxing.
Champion in 90 was Tyson, right?
Well, at one point, yes, he was.
Okay.
At another point in 1990, he did not. he was the loser in this bout.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I know who it is.
Who beat Tyson in 1990? I should know this.
Well, it's going to drive you crazy if you don't get it.
Oh, I know it will. It always does. Who beat Tyson in 90? How long was the victor the champion?
Never again, I believe.
I don't think he did defend.
No, he just didn't defend at all. Okay.
Yeah.
But you know who he is. You know, if I'm right about this. I'm like, I'm pretty sure I know this, but I'm not 100%.
Who do you think it is?
Buster Douglas.
That's exactly who it is. Thank you.
Buster Douglas with a 10th round KO.
Oh, I should have known that.
And, ooh, man. See, now, Samantha, since you were all nailing all these, I should have been throwing the Iditarod at you. Because that was a fun one.
Oh, I would never have known that. I don't believe in the Iditarod. I don't like it. I think it's me.
Can I just say how happy I am that the rules of this game are not the same as Jeopardy?
That's true. Yeah.
We get killed right now.
All right, so now that we've had our sports fun, because you guys kind of knew that I was going to throw an angle like that at y'all, let's do what we did last week also. I'm more of a movies guy over music, so I'm going to make you do movies.
Ooh.
Top grossing films. Anything in the top 10, I'll give you credit for.
Okay. 1990 was definitely Doc Hollywood, I think, was 1990.
Home Alone. Let's go back to that again, except the original Home Alone.
The original Home Alone, yeah.
I'm pretty sure 1990. God, Pretty Woman, right? I think.
See, I thought that was 91. I thought Pretty Woman was...
It's either 89 or 90. I'm thinking, I'm almost positive Dick Tracy was this year, but I don't know if that actually made it. I don't even know if that made it money, though. And what else? Die Hard 2, or was that 91?
That I think was 91.
What else?
I don't know why, but Rocketeer's in my head.
I think that's later.
I think you're right. I think it's like 94.
Oh, what about... Oh, God, what's that goofy movie with the race cars?
Days of Thunder?
Thank you. Yeah. Is that 1990?
Possibly. One of the Lethal Weapons was 1990. I think that might be two.
Yeah, I bet you're right.
I think Lethal Weapon 2 was 1990.
What about Die Hard 2? Wouldn't that be that year, too? Or, well, actually, I don't know.
I wouldn't.
It might be a year before.
Maybe. I really want to think Die Hard 2 was 91. No, wait, no, it was 90. Because Die Hard 1 was 88, right?
Yeah. So 3 is way later.
Way later. So, but they made 2. 2 was a standard sequel. It's
like pretty quick. Yeah. So I'm thinking that
was 1990.
Right.
Yeah, Die Hard 2. Which means they probably released it around Christmas, so it's not the top grossing, though, kind of like Aladdin from last week.
Yeah, I bet you're right.
So that may not be top 10, but it's on the list somewhere.
I think what else? Steel Magnolias?
Ooh, good pull. Was that 90?
I don't know. Sometime around there. This is the problem, is I can think of so many movies that are like, I could nail it down to like a 3-year range, but I'm not
sure
it was this year.
Wasn't Pretty Woman Julia Roberts' like first major film?
It was her first big role. I think her first movie was Mystic Pizza, but
right.
I think Pretty Woman was her breakout role.
Right, and then Steel Magnolias follows. So Steel Magnolias may be more like 91, 92.
Yeah, they have to go in that order. Yeah, because we already knew who she was.
Yeah.
So that's got to be later.
Right.
God, what else? There's so many things, like, I mean, it's two, I think Little Mermaid was the year before, right? I don't know if we have a Disney this year, and Beauty and the Beast, I know, is 91, so there may not be a Disney.
What about Super Mario Brothers, that awful, god-awful ugh film that they
did. I don't think I saw that. I was thinking about that Ninja Turtle movie, but I think that was earlier.
That was 91. 91 or 92.
Oh, okay. No, I was thinking of earlier. I know. That was more like 88.
Yeah, no, the first one is. I'm thinking of the second one. And the second one actually might be 90.
Oh.
Now that I think about it. 91? Maybe 91?
I thought I was like 6 when I saw that movie, but maybe they're newer than I thought.
By the way, as an adult, go back and watch them. They're quite obnoxiously wow.
Are they bad? I had a feeling. I was like, I feel like these are...
They're not bad. They're actually fun to watch, but it's very thick in nostalgia, and you're wondering, like, what the hell was I thinking? Oh, that's right. I was 8.
Oh, well, and I think, like, it's, like, definitely one of those movies that hasn't aged well in terms of, like, what, I mean, I'm using air quotes when I say it, but special effects. Uh-huh. Like, and that, remember that Baltimore song that played, like, throughout the movie? It sounds like a Tarzan yodeling. like all of my thoughts about Ninja Turtles, which is, I'm pretty sure, not even in this year. But maybe the second one was, I don't know. Now I kind of want to go back and watch them. And this is too late for The Wizard. I know you and I talk about The Wizard all the time.
Oh, so, God, but yeah.
The Wizard was before this.
What about Little also, Monsters?
I don't think I know what that is.
Little Monsters, it's Fred Savage,
Oh, I do know what you mean. I've never seen that, though. But, I know the movie you mean, though. Was that that year?
Maybe. It's possible.
What else? I think...
See, Turner was
like, okay, Terminator 2 is, like, 92, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's too early for that. And I think Kindergarten Cop is later, too?
Yeah, that's, like, 94.
That was, like, 94. I don't know. No idea. Edward Scissorhands?
Ooh, maybe. Maybe.
Although I doubt that made a lot of money.
No.
I feel like that was a box office flop.
When did Tim Burton really take off? Because that was one of his early...
That would have been one of the first, like, successful ones. Although I think that was one of those movies that was successful in spite of itself. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Like that, like no one thought was good, and everybody liked it anyway. I think. I don't know.
All right, I think you guys have done pretty good here.
Oh really?
So I'm gonna. Well, you've done good on some of these things you mentioned. I like where y'all are. You got 4 of the top 10.
Ooh,
although you tiptoed on one of them. You tiptoed on one of them. So you may decide to give you credit. We'll all decide here.
Okay.
So some of the things y'all mentioned, Kindergarten Cop. Yes, that was actually a Christmas weekend release. Came out December 22nd. So didn't score as high because of that.
Come in the following year.
That was way earlier than I remember. Okay.
Yeah.
I thought that was 92. Okay.
Wow.
Little Mermaid, but that was a November 17th release, so it only ranks as high as 31st.
Oh, wow. So we're a year late. I was thinking Little Mermaid was the year before. But in fact, play the end of the year. Okay. Okay.
Weird thing, out the exact same day, Steel Magnolias came out the exact same day as Little Mermaid, November 17th, 1990.
Oh, so are we wrong about Pretty Woman? Was that 89?
Oh, no, Pretty Woman is in the top 10. Oh, yes.
So it wasn't.
No, I'm just going through yours. The ones that y'all threw out that didn't make it. Another one that y'all threw out that finished 12th, Days of Thunder. Well done on that one.
Nice.
Days of Thunder finished 12th.
Okay.
So your top 10... great job on the Dick Tracy that finished 9th.
Oh, yeah. I love that movie. I was obsessed with that movie. I don't really know why, but I loved it.
One that y'all tiptoed a little bit, but I'm definitely giving you credit, Die Hard 2 finished 7th. Die Hard 2 was a July 6th release, not a Christmas time release.
But it's a Christmas movie.
Yeah, it's a Christmas movie.
Well, people.
I think this proves that Die Hard, the first one, is definitely a Christmas movie. But yeah, Die Hard 2 was released in July 6th.
Mm.
Get that blockbuster. let's decide if you guys get credit a little bit on number 4, The original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Oh,
March
30th, 1990. That was 90? God, for some reason,
yeah. I really thought I was like way younger.
Yeah, I thought that
like was, a lot younger.
I thought that was 88, and like the second one came out in 90, 91. That's what I thought.
I thought we were like really, really little kids
when yeah.
the first one came out. So did or I. maybe I just felt like a really little kid because I went to see it in the theater, but I was clearly too old for it. You were four on the inside.
By the way, you feel free to at me on Twitter on this one. But the original, the OG April O'Neil is my favorite. She had the right attitude. She had the spunk.
There you go.
She had the spunk to be April O'Neil. The other ones are just, eh. Hey, don't even get me started on Megan Fox as April O'Neil. No.
Yikes.
No.
Yeah. So, all right. So third, number three, y'all did get this crazy thing here. This goes along, and I want to throw in, too, that November weekend was crazy, apparently, in 1990. We already mentioned Little Mermaid, Steel Magnolias. Rocky V came out that same weekend.
Oh, I forgot about
the And Rockies. Also out that weekend, number three, the original Home Alone.
Okay.
How about that lineup?
Okay. Wow.
See, Home Alone, Steel Magnolias, Little Mermaid, and Rocky V all the same week.
See, that was back in the good old days of cinema. We don't have that anymore, right? Where you were all of these distributors would take like these massively huge films and they would actually stack them up and put them on the same weekend just to see how they did.
We
don't have that anymore.
Credit to Home Alone coming out mid-November, it still grossed $143 million in that, what?
I wonder,
that is your top grossing film, even though I know technically you're saying it's not, but it should be, because if it made that much money in like a month and a half, like that's ridiculous.
See, All right,
the other one that y'all guessed.
Hang on, real quick. Now, Irby, I know there's, because you know, I just did this last week. There's no way to know like how it like how quickly that money came in, but I'm curious, the original Home Alone, unless they marketed it well, unless that trailer was everywhere, how much of that was word of mouth? How much of that was people that went to the theater, saw Home Alone, and said, you guys have to see this film?
I'm sure there was a little bit of that. It's also that it is a Christmas movie. Yeah. That helped with the Christmas season. But sure. Yeah, 143 million of its 285 million came in those first 7 weeks. So well done there.
Wow.
All right, Pretty Woman. You guys threw out Pretty Woman. Pretty Woman finished second. So well done on that. Well done on the Julie Roberts. The other top tens that y'all didn't hit. Number 10, Back to the Future Part 3.
That was 1990. Yeah.
I saw that. I thought that was late.
May 1990. Number 8, Driving Miss Daisy.
Oh, God.
Oh.
No.
Number 6, you guys were tiptoeing with some Schwarzenegger, but you didn't get this one. Total Recall.
Oh. See, now I'm upset because I should have thought of that one. I didn't dip into my Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I've never actually seen library. That, but I should have known that was around that.
Yeah, that was definitely 1990. Everything about it was 1990. It was half 80s, half 90s.
So true. Number 5, this is one that I threw out maybe earlier in the week to Samantha just to find out that she hasn't seen this movie. That's okay. The Hunt for Red October.
Well, now I know what it is.
yep, what was it?
Seen that one.
The Hunt for Red October finished 5th.
Ooh. Oh, yeah, that would be around then. Okay.
All right, so all we're missing is number one.
Oh, my God.
Number one.
Can you give us a hint? Can you give us a hint?
Yes, yes, yes. So this movie was released in mid-July in 1990. It would, if we're going to go genres, it is a drama romance.
Drama romance? Drama romance. God, am I not going to know there?
No, you guys are going to know this.
Everything I can think of is more like comedy romance. like When Harry Met Sally. That's not a drama. Wait, is this like a sad movie drama or like
yes.
a defense drama? Oh, sad drama.
Sad drama.
I probably have never seen it. I don't know.
It's difficult. I'm trying to think what else to do, because if I throw out the main people, you're gonna get it.
Can you give us the supporting cast?
Give us another movie that the main people were in.
Oh, okay, that works too. Let's do that.
Oof.
Or one of the main people or something.
So the main actress in this movie would have some kind of relational connection with the Die Hard movies?
Oh, so Demi Moore.
And the main guy in this...
I know what the movie is.
Okay. Demi Moore.
I've never seen this movie, but I know what it is, I think.
The main guy, You know, at some point, this guy, he liked to surf. And he liked to surf with somebody that ended up in the Matrix.
Oh, it's Ghost.
He was, yeah.
There you go.
Oh, Ghost. I was going to say, I was like, oh, this guy was one of the greatest, like, stupid action movies ever in Roadhouse.
Oh, yeah, that's, yeah. I was trying to think, like, I couldn't do anything with Roadhouse, or I was like, man, if I do that, it's going to be too obvious.
I almost went,
he kind of was a Chippendale.
You know,
that I wouldn't have done.
Yeah, you sold me on Point Break.
Point Break, yeah. There you go, well done.
Point Break or Roadhouse. That was a good pick.
Ghost was 1990, I feel old now. Wow.
July 13th, 1990.
Wow. You can see why that would be number one.
Really?
I think so.
I thought that was just a movie that, like, middle-aged women saw.
Wait, look at the cast of Ghost. You had Swayze, you had Demi Moore, you had...
I know, but isn't it,
Whoopi Goldberg was in that.
Isn't there a dead lady, like, banging a ghost, like, in a pottery studio or something? Isn't that the whole point of that movie? Like, I thought that was for middle-aged women who were divorced. I've just been...
There was a lot of... Think about what else was around at that time. You had that weird series called, what, 30-something was this weird-ass series we had? There was a lot of this stuff going around in the early 1990s, late 80s.
I don't remember this, probably because my mom didn't watch stuff like that, so we never saw it. My mom wouldn't have been interested.
It was out there. Yeah, well, you also had the growth of the Brat Pack in the 80s with St. Elmo's Fire. I mean, like, that was the type of movies.
That's like a different animal, though. I was thinking more of, like, Beaches. All those Bette Midler movies, because the girl who lived across the street from me, her mom loved those, and my mom thought they were stupid. Ghost.
Ghost?
Wow. I don't think I could have told you the year for that one. Like, some of them you're just like, oh, yeah, of course. I don't think I could have pinned that down to 1990, but I think it's a little difficult when you haven't seen the movie. I'm surprised that was the number one movie, but oh, you're right. There was a lot of that going around.
There was a lot of it going around.
Good Lord. A weird face for that, for, like, weird tearjerkers for adult women.
Basically, everything that's on Lifetime now was a big hit in 1990.
Oh, no. Oh, no. I'm glad I was too young to know about this, and I was just like, Home Alone. Or, you know, if you're lucky, you get to stay up past your bedtime, Die Hard too.
You know,
glad I missed this face.
You know, we joked on Twitter about the Slugger's Wife. Same MO earlier. I think that was an 80s movie. But
I don't know what that is either, though.
Same MO. Oh, it's a fun movie. I think it might actually have been one of it's either one of or the first film that Rebecca De Mornay ever did.
Oh, that's why we were talking about that, because last week you were talking about Hand the Rocks the Cradle. That's
yes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, because Rebecca De Mornay, right, because I'm afraid because of that movie. Poor Rebecca. Sorry about that. You did too good of a job. And then I was terrified of you for the rest of my life. Just like I'm still afraid of Jack Nicholson. Because of The Shining.
So one last one I'll leave you with, one that y'all probably you would have liked to have gotten as a good honorable mention that came out that year. Did not make the top 10 grossing because it was late in the year, but ended up grossing over $184 million. That was one, Dances with Wolves.
Ew. Oh, no. Worst movie ever.
Awful. Awful.
Worst movie ever. I can't believe people showed that to kids. I can't believe they thought it was necessary to do that. Like, two thumbs down.
I can't believe Kevin Costner did it.
If you want, there's a whole other round of those coming out now.
I'm a little mad at Costner. I can't believe he did that. Terrible judgment. Terrible judgment.
Awful. Awful.
Like, I love
awful
you, Kevin film. Costner, but, like, just worst movie ever. Just, like, needlessly cruel and depressing to the audience. Like, absolutely hate it.
And that
like,
was
Old Yeller for grown-ups.
And that was when Kevin Costner was in his prime, too.
Yeah, he didn't need to do that. Like, or you could have just written it differently. How about that? Like, how about you don't just, like, needlessly, oh my gosh, I don't even want to say it because I don't want to think about it. But like
awful film.
Yeah. Two thumbs down. Zero stars out of five.
Can we actually get negative stars? Like more like a negative eight.
Negative eight out of zero for that film.
Exactly.
Well, now I feel bad for bringing it up for you, poor guy. Sorry.
Yeah, you triggered that.
You should. Now we both have trauma. Jeez, man.
You know,
Ghosts we could have handled, you know, Dead Lady in a Pottery Studio. We were okay with that.
Hey, okay. Just to spin this around, Irby, is the movie The Abyss on your list anywhere for 1990?
It was a 1989 release.
Damn. See, I knew I was going to run into this.
Okay.
89 and 90 are so alike.
Yeah.
That was
hard to. Yeah,
that's what was fun when I was actually setting this up, is because I started this whole segment by deciding on 1990. I went back and forth between 89 and 90, plenty of good stuff, because of the wanting to make you guys go through all those fun sports information and champions. That's why I decided on 1990. So
that was
the Abyss. We would have been discussing that.
That's a great movie, The Abyss. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, that is a good movie. Mm-hmm. I like that movie. I haven't seen that in like a really long time.
It's been a long time, yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, Herbs, what else you got for us for 1990?
No, that is it. That's it. I don't want to keep you guys too much longer. I think movies, you guys know me. I'm not a big music person. I'm a movies and sports, so I figured that was enough fun stuff to make you guys go through, and y'all did pretty good there. You did pretty good. You got everything. Samantha, definitely some nice long three-pointers there with some of my random sports trivia. Well done.
Did you pull in any music at all? Because I'm willing to bet you that, not a steak bet, because I'm still very much deficient on, you know, how much actual beef I owe you guys. But I'm fairly confident that because Pretty Woman was so high, that the title track of Pretty Woman, which was... it's a song by Roxette. What was it called? It must have been love.
It must have been love.
It's gotta be.
I'm pretty sure it was number two. Because I know what you know what number one was this year.
I don't.
Hold On by Wilson Phillips.
Oh.
See, you know what, guys? Forget Dances with Wolves. That is a perfect way to end this. Y'all just went 1-2 there at the end. Yes. Number one, Hold On, Wilson Phillips. Number two, It Must Have Been Love, Roxette. Well done. Good job. Like a good Formula One team, y'all just went 1-2.
All right. So we are not like Max. Neither one of us is Max for Saturday this weekend. We are good teammates, Bo.
Yeah.
Long distance high five.
Long distance.
All right, great stuff,
Irby. Oh, that was fun. That was fun. This is gonna be a fun segment, I think, over the course of the rest of the NFL season. Anyway, all right, that's gonna do it for us, though. We're out of here. Until next week, watch some football. It's football weekend. We've got college rivalry weekend. We've got the NFL on Thursday. On Sunday, on Monday, and even more games on Thursday than we're used to. So watch some football. It's good for you. Something else is good for you. Give us a like. Give us a subscribe. Give us a review. Leave us a review. Reach out to us on Twitter. We'll be back next week. Until then, have a happy Thanksgiving. Who you gonna call? Ghostbusters!